Have Hello? A seat.
How's it going?
Thank you. Are you guys live?
We are live.
You are.
We are. This is Jim Norton and Jim Florentine.
Good,
yes.
Good. Good to meet you. I don't think we've ever met before. I don't think you've ever been on our show.
I don't think so, no. I think you guys turned me down.
Did we really?
Yeah.
No, probably when it was an old, not because Jim and Sam together, we've been together since October.
Oh, since October? No, so since we couldn't. October you haven't turned me down.
Yeah. Couldn't have. Cool. Couldn't have.
We're good now.
Good, good. Excellent. Okay. Excellent.
How you guys doing?
Just pull a little closer to them, my buddy.
Sure.
Yeah, how are you doing?
I'm grateful every day, man. It's a good life.
Are
yeah,
you?
I mean, you get to do a TV show with The Rock. You better be grateful, right?
I know. What a Ballers premiering this Sunday, the 23rd. And I had a great time on the show. So well written, so well produced, really nice people. I'm grateful.
You look pretty good. You stay in shape, obviously.
I'm lucky. My dad has always been a fitness guy. He's a U.S. Army Ranger, New York City policeman. So always taught us great health and keeping our mind in good shape. And I get a lot of plastic surgery and tons of Botox.
Do you really?
Pretty good.
At least you admit it.
Oh, yeah. I'll get it all in my ass.
You and me both.
It's all ass.
Right.
Yeah. I've heard tight ass.
They say Steve Gutenberg has the smoothest cheeks in Hollywood.
Yeah.
So
right.
That's
very spankable.
I gotta tell you.
So your dad was a ranger. Was he like strict? If he's a cop and a ranger, those are like two real alpha male jobs.
Yeah. You know, the great thing about my dad is he taught me about being on time. You know, if you say to my dad,
right.
8 months from now on a Thursday at 4 o'clock, you have to be there. For the next 8 months, all he talks about is, by the way, you know, in 8 months, we got to be there at 4 o'clock. I know, Dad. We're going to be there at 4 o'clock.
He's obsessed about being on time.
He is an on-time guy, and he's a great guy to give a plan to, my dad. You give him a plan, you know, he planned to fight and fight to plan. That's his thing. And so I grew up in a good family.
Did
my
he see combat
did.
Or no, in as a ranger?
Sorry?
Did he see any combat as a ranger?
Oh, yeah, man. They dropped him all over the place in Korea, and he worked in Germany, and he was in charge of lots of operations that he couldn't even tell us about. But I'll tell you an interesting thing that happened. Years ago, they used to live in Florida, and my dad won't talk about a lot of the operations he did, and we're sitting in a mall. My mom went to a shop, and we're sitting there with my dad, and a man walks by and sees my dad and stops in front of my dad and salutes my dad. And my dad salutes him, and he walks away. And my mom was just coming up, and she goes, Stanley, who was that? He goes, nobody. And I go, no, Dad, mom met the guy who saluted you. Who was that? He said, nobody. And I said, but Dad, people just don't salute people. Who's that? He goes, you don't need to know. And it was scary as hell.
Yeah.
You know, it was like, Dad, who was that guy? Because my dad has, you know,
and he never told you.
Yeah, my dad's, you know, U.S. Army Ranger. You're doing a lot of stuff.
Weird, though, when you realize that your dad has this private life that you know nothing about?
Right,
there's this
how
other
dare
side
you?
Of him
how dare
that, like,
you?
You're not a part of. And you
exactly.
don't know. You can't comment on. You don't know that guy.
None of your business. None of your business. None, and I just, so they obviously, later on, I kind of squeezed it out of them that they were on operation together, which was classified, and that's it.
You know, back
wow.
in those days, they didn't
that
talk about
classified.
Stuff either. They didn't talk about feelings. Like, a lot of those people come back from World War II and Korea, and they're like, I wish we could have just talked to people about this stuff, like the stuff they saw. Like, those guys just stuffed it all in and were like, oh, no, everything's okay. Like, there's just this different generation of men than we are now.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, the service does that, and the draft did that. You know, a guy went into the service at 18 or 19 and came out at 21, came out a man. You know, our generation, we don't have that luxury, in essence, of learning to sleep in a barrack with 50 other guys, to get online. I don't care if you're, you know, you're Elvis or you're Jimmy Stewart. You stand online like everybody
right.
else. There's a really great rod of steel you get by being in the service. I'm actually sorry I wasn't in the service. I think it would have matured me a great deal. I frankly, I'm 58. I've just matured. You know, I've just committed to a woman. I'm going to get married. I want to have a family. I want to have a real life. I haven't done that for my entire somewhat adult life.
That gives me hope. I'm 9 years younger than you. Sorry, I got a few more years to fuck around.
So you've never been married?
I was married once. It
okay.
didn't work.
Oh. Right.
And I've been single a long,
and no
long
kids.
Time. And no kids. And I finally matured. But, you know, my dad had children at 24. My mom had children, had me at 19.
Wow.
So, you know, she was a woman at 19. You know, not running around, you know, on the cell phone, checking your emails right. and where am I going tonight? And
how
you know,
how do you do that? How do you like have kind of this Hollywood life on one end where you're like not really committed to anything, you're making a ton of money, you get to hang out with celebrities, you get to fuck women all you want, you get to do all this stuff. But the other side of you, it's kind of like your dad. The other side of you is you were raised with this kind of rigid structure yeah. and you work for every inch that you get and blah, blah, blah. Like, how does that...
It saved me.
How does that even... the that side saved you.
Saved me, sure.
How?
You know, temptation is great. And, you know, you can walk into the wrong room in the film and television and theater business often, especially as a young person. And I was lucky not to... if I walked into the wrong room, I looked around and said, I don't belong here.
Did you almost go down some bad roads?
Yeah, of course. Absolutely. I mean, man, oh, man. You know what it's like, you know, being in the entertainment business. You get invited places that your friends don't get invited.
Yeah.
You know, and you get to hang out at in parties later and go into the rooms that you're not, the other normal yeah. average guys don't go in.
Playboy Mansion.
And Playboy Mansion.
You used to go there?
Yes, sir.
How was it?
It was like going to the White House. You kiss the doorknob. Do you know how many, you know, when I went to the Playboy Mansion, I'll never forget, I was invited to Playboy Mansion. There's two ways to go there. You get to drive your car up to the mansion, but the first time you go, you have to take a bus from UCLA. They meet at UCLA, and the mansion is down Sunset Boulevard. So I got an invitation to the mansion. It was a Halloween party of some sort. So I drive up, I park my car in the parking structure, and I'm looking around, it's empty. I go, where's the bus? You know, where's the bus? I'm walking around like a schmuck. Where's the bus? Then I see a group of people way down there and a bus. I go, oh, there it is. I walk, and there's sort of, it seems like there are lots of girls. I didn't see many guys, no guys. Then I'm getting closer. Looks like there's girls in lingerie. And like nurse outfits and, you know, cheerleader outfits. And closer I get, there's 30 girls and one guy standing there. And I'm scared to death. I start getting, you know, I'm getting goosebumps right now. I'm thinking about it. And I'm walking up there. I'm nervous as hell, you know. And then there's a guy and he comes over to me. He goes, hey, man, we're going to the Playboy Mansion. I didn't know him. We became best friends right away. We were holding on to each other. We get on the bus full of girls in lingerie. We're sitting next to each other going, can you believe it? We'll go to the mansion. You drive up a private driveway. There's one of these traffic signs that says, caution, bunnies crossing. And we're grabbing each other going, bunnies crossing. We drive up and there it is. And you get out, and looks like there's thousands of women walking around, all in lingerie. And you're looking up, and you walk up there, and you grab the handle of the door. And, you know, I said to this guy, Michael Linton, who's actually a great musician, we became friends then. And I said, do you know how many people have held this door? You know, whether it's Jack Nicholson and Jimmy Kahn and, you know, Clinton and who hasn't been here? And you walk in. And the mansion is everything you ever thought it would be. And it was like, you know, one of the most exciting moments. You know, it's literally for a man.
Sure.
It's like going to the White House.
Yeah.
And
it's like Charlie and the Chocolate Factory right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, it really is.
It's like unbelievable. And they had the grotto and private rooms and all, you know, it was just, and I knew a few people there and they took me around the private area and the zoo. But I was lucky in those similar situations. In my career, I never got caught in the dark room, and I always got out.
Did you get laid when you were there?
I can't say.
Sure you can. You don't have to say her name.
I can't say.
Okay.
I can't say because I get too much going on.
All right.
I can't say. All I can say is interesting place. I can't say anything.
Okay. Can I ask it like this?
I can't.
All right. Fair enough.
All right. Can I say it like this?
Yeah.
When you walked in, from the time you walked in and the time you walked out, did you have less semen when you walked out?
I got to go there many, many times. And then I got to drive my car up there. And then I met Hef for a second there. And anyway.
I went.
I've never been. They tried to get me in, and then they said no. I've never gone.
And there are, like, I went once.
With Big A.
You did
with
go.
Big A, yeah. And
Big
it was,
A?
He's a guy
he's
on
a
our
fan
show.
Of our show.
He's a friend. But it was more like, it wasn't like one of the classic Playboy parties. It was a promotional.
It was a charity promotion, yeah.
And so it was a different deal. But right. We did still tour the grounds and everything. And there are sex rooms everywhere. Like, there's this little game room house. Yeah. Like, it's a separate structure.
That's it. That's it's cool. Got and from all the 70s.
It's got all the arcade games and stuff
oh,
in
that's
it.
Fun.
But then on either end, it's also got rooms where there's, like, velvet beds and
but
mirrors.
But here's what made, I heard what made the Playboy label and the brand. He was a really great host and a good man and a good friend. And the great thing about his parties, I heard, I was never there when he was in his vital days. He would see you and he'd say, hey, man, I got to introduce you to Jimmy Kahn. Come over here. And he'd pull you over and introduce you to somebody. He goes, what do you need to drink? What do you need to eat? The food was great. He was a great host.
And he made everyone feel important and valued. Yes. Yeah, I've heard great things. And like,
great guy.
There was a show, Jimmy, you stood up. I thought you were leaving.
Oh, no, I just had a little cramp.
There was, they used to do a show out of the Playboy Mansion.
Playboy After Dark.
Yeah, where they had like really great, like he showed a lot of black talent before a lot of people. There's like really weird footage of fucking Moms Mabley singing. What's that song? The song that she became famous for.
Yeah.
He had really crazy groups of eclectic guests. It was really an interesting
place. It was a little
place.
Saturday Night Live. They're always on the edge, always bringing new talent, smart guys, great writers, great jazz musicians.
Did you go through a period where you were an asshole? Like, because you're like the nicest dude ever, and I think, you know, that's kind of your reputation right now. But like when you're at the height of your comedy career, like when all the Police Academy movies are coming out, and Three Men and a Baby, and all this stuff, and it's just all happening all at once for you, and all these movies are giant movies.
Holy cheese and crackers, man. What's going on with you? Of course I had my asshole period.
You did.
I mean, absolutely,
good.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But they didn't last long.
How come? What shook you
out
of
them? I have too much real around me.
Was it your family?
Yeah,
again?
Family, friends. Yeah. You know, it's not. Like,
what are you doing? What are you acting?
Well, I don't know what, you know, like, I don't really remember what
like
I would
like, just
do.
Maybe a demand on a set or something like that.
Yeah,
on
I had one incident. I'll tell you a very interesting story. I'm on a set, and somewhere I saw a hat that said, "Do I look like I give a shit?" I always thought that was a great line. I saw this hat said, "Do I look like I give a shit?" So I was on the set one time, and I was the big shot of the set, and a guy came over to me and asked me to do something. I don't know what I got into me, and I said, do I look like I give a shit? And
because it was just in your head.
It was in my head. And the guy,
you saw a hat.
The guy kind of looked at me and was like, walked away. Now, for about 20 years, I felt bad that I said that. One day, and his name was Richard. Never forget, he was the production manager. I walked up to a restaurant, and there he was sitting there. And I walked up to him, and I said, Richard. And he said, oh, hi. I go, do you remember me? He goes, yeah, of course. I go, I want to apologize to you for saying years ago, do I look like I give a shit? And he said, when? And I told him, and he said, I don't remember. And, you know, for 20 years, I'm walking around going, I've hurt that guy's feelings.
He didn't even remember.
No, because like, they're on sets. They're used to it. Like, all right, yeah, Gutenberg was a dick for 10 seconds, and that was the end of it.
Who knows? He thought it was a joke. Or whatever.
Right, right.
But I work hard on being positive and having integrity and being nice and being thoughtful. I work hard every day. When I wake up in the morning, I work on it. That devil comes in there, man. And, you know, listen, I was born in Brooklyn. I grew up with a Brooklyn mother. You know, I can say fuck you up yours all day, but I don't want to do that. I want to be a good person. I want to be a nice person. I want to rise above what those base emotions, you know, that we all have. And I really work on it.
Can I ask you, if you remember, I want to something for Joey.
Oh, yeah, man. Great John Cappelletti story.
That was your first, one of the first things you got?
Absolutely, yeah. I got to work with the great Mark Singer, who was a great Shakespearean actor who played John Cappelletti. I was really lucky in that show.
Who were you in that?
I played one of John's brothers, and I had a small role, but it was one of my first supporting roles.
And you went out for it, and you landed the audition?
Sure, I got an audition, and I got the part.
I'm always interested in people's, like, the first couple of things they did, because it's, like, so important. It's, like, usually it's a small role, but then it's, like, what is it in that, like, propels you forward?
Well, you know, you got to really be a go-getter in show business, and especially film and television, theater, too. You got to, you know, keep hocking your agent, keep pumping them, coming in, saying hello. I used to wander the halls of the William Morris Agency all day. Knocking on people. Hi, just want to say hi. Thanks a lot. Get out of here. Hi, just want to say hi. Hey, come in here. I got something for you. I would do it all
you
day
would.
And night. Kevin Costner, too. I would pass him in the hall. He'd be doing the same thing. Hi, how you doing? It's Kevin. Just want to say hi. You know, we're all actors. It's a tough gig to get.
Very hard, because you have to actually land something and be seen. Like, the people ask me, like, how do I make it in the acting, or I got to do, I don't know what to fucking tell. Like, a stand-up, you go on and you try it, but at least you can have an audience. Yeah. Acting is so brutal, because where do people see you?
Well, great thing about stand-up is it's live theater. It really is a one-man show. So you get to do your show. As an actor, you have to be invited to a production. But right. you know, you got to keep your head. You got to stay poised. You got to be ready. You got to be prepared. Every day you got to do your readings. You got to read great plays, great movies, great parts. You got to practice. No matter what, you got to be ready for that opportunity. And you need a hit. There are so many great actors working right now in Minneapolis at the Guthrie who can act circles around everybody in Hollywood. They just don't have the break. You need a hit movie.
And they're also not in the right place.
Yeah, and stand-up, doing stand-up is easier to audition, I think, going in that room with three people at a table, because we're used to performing in front of people.
Yeah.
As an actor, it's probably tougher.
It's tough.
You know, so we're like, all right, I performed in front of three people last night, so it's not a big deal.
That's right. You're doing theater all the time. Guys who do theater are the best prepared actors on the planet. Because you're doing it. You're working it. They don't like that joke. You say a joke, it doesn't land. Okay, I'm moving on. I'll get it tomorrow.
Are you good at auditioning?
I'm okay at auditioning. I mean, no.
You probably don't have to do it anymore. But
sure, I do.
You do.
Oh, absolutely.
What's the last thing you had to audition for?
Wow. How long ago was it? What did I audition for that I didn't? Oh, yeah. There was a show about music. I flew to Chicago, a movie about music. I flew to Chicago to audition for the director, and I did not get the lead. I got a smaller part in it. I think they're calling it black music right now or something to that effect. But I flew in.
On your own dime, you fly
in. Yeah,
because
the guy said
this...
no. The guy said no, and I said, if I come in, will he see me? He said yes, and I still didn't
That's amazing, but you still did it, though. I respect that a lot because... Yeah. A lot of times they say they want something and they're not 100% sure what they want. And then the fact is, he probably liked the fact that you came and you did a good enough job. He's like, oh, use him as this. At least you're in
and
it.
And he gave me another part, you know, and I was happy with the other part. I wanted the lead, but I didn't get it.
But your ego didn't crush you. Like the fact that his ego didn't crush you.
No.
And you go, fuck that. Ralph Macchio told a story, I think, about.
What a nice man, Ralph.
He is a very nice guy, but about being My Cousin Vinny. And they didn't have him in mind or they didn't want him for the role. And he goes, let me just read for it. Petitioned to read for it. And I would never have that kind of pride in my work. Like, I really respect guys who, like, let me just see me and then make your
decision.
That's
the craft.
Yeah.
That's the craft. You have to have, you know, years ago when I was in acting school here in the city, we went to the Bronx Zoo. All the animals, what's the most important? The rhinoceros. That's the one that has tough skin. That's what you need.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you're going to get hit all day and night. I don't care who you are.
How did you end up getting Ballers?
Ballers was great. Stephen Levinson, the producer, and Julian Farino, the director, asked me to lunch. We talked. They said, we got some material for you to read. I read it. I said,
that's got to be the best kind of lunch ever, by the
way. Oh, my God, yeah.
It was great. And they said, we would like to invite you to be part of our show. And I said, oh, thank you so much. And we started.
So wait, they asked you to read it and then not read it to them.
No,
but
just read
to see if you liked it.
Yeah.
See, that's the advantage of being famous. They're like, this reminds me of Steve Guttenberg. Let's just see if he wants it.
Well, you start getting older as an actor, too. And the older parts are the great parts. That's, you know, if you can get out of your ingenue life. And,
what's that mean?
You know, get out of the young guy, the guy with the gun, the guy kissing the girl and everything, and grow up and start playing the older Spencer Tracy roles, the Gene Hackman roles, you know, the Alfred Drake roles, you know, the Leslie Howard roles. You want to support the star. William Wyler, one of the greatest directors ever, always said the hardest part to cast is Spencer Tracy, is Jimmy Stewart, is Clark Gable. That's the hard part. Dwayne Johnson, those are George Clooney, because those characteristics are hard to come by. But the second most important, the guys who support him, you know, or the Cecil Hawthorne, or whether it's, you just go on and on.
John Cazale.
John Cazale, who I actually audited one of his acting classes.
Oh, wow.
One of the great acting teachers
you
of
did.
All time, of course.
How did you audit his acting class?
He had classes everywhere, and if you wanted to join in, and actually he was at the studio and all over, you could come in and you could sit in the gallery and watch the class.
Oh, that's great. So you watched him teach acting?
Yeah, one of the greatest teachers. Wow. You know,
what was he talking about? Like, what did he say when he was teaching acting? What kind of a message was he sending to his acting students? Because he was so incredible.
Well, he was doing scene work, so it was really specific. I just remember him talking about being specific, not being general in your moves. Put the glass down, concentrate, being specific. He was a very big proponent of being specific in your work. Wow. What a great actor, huh?
Yeah. Yeah, but as a supporting guy, like he's, you know,
yeah,
probably nobody ever better.
But that's a very important part.
That's right.
Best supporting actor, you're supporting the star, you're supporting the story. And I'm so honored that Ballers asked me, as an older guy, to be part of this show. Because, you know, a lot of the the integrity of a show, not only is the star, but it spreads out, and you want to believe everything. So it was a great feather in my cap to play this part and be a heavy.
Right.
You know, great Alfred Drake, one of the greatest Shakespearean actors of all time, when I was young, told me, as you get older, you want to play the DA, the father, the villain. You want to be the villain. You want to be Seymour Hoffman against Tom Cruise.
Yes.
It's a great compliment.
Yes.
Because the better the villain, the better the hero. You need a great villain, Alan Rickman, to make Bruce Willis look so good. You know, I mean, the list goes on and on. You need great villains. And also, always, the villains are always the nicest guys. You know,
in real life, they always are.
Yeah.
You know, because they're calling on emotions they don't have. You know, who's that great guy who played the Green Hornet, the Green Goblin in Spider-Man?
Willem Dafoe,
who has the equipment of a villain,
right?
But he's not a villain.
But a good villain can overshadow a good hero. Like Sergeant Barnes to me overshadowed Willem Dafoe in Platoon, or Heath Ledger over Batman. Like a good villain, Darth Vader was always better than Luke Skywalker. Like a good villain can fucking steal the movie.
And then when the villain dies, and when you beat the villain, it makes the hero even better.
Mm-hmm.
And that's Joseph Campbell. That's Campbellian myth, which is the greatest. If you guys have a chance to look up Joseph Campbell. He's one of the greatest storytellers of all time. And Star Wars, whether it's Spielberg or whether it's Lucas or any of the great storytellers, always go back to Campbellian myth. You need a strong villain, and you need a surprise ending. You kill the villain, and the hero is almost beaten, but he's starting to stand up, and he's killed the villain, and behind him, the villain starts to stand up, and you got one more battle. And those are the great stories where the hero turns around and goes, I just shot him in the head, and he's standing up. You know, it's Terminator, where the Terminator has to really the final battle of the villain. So it's great storytelling. It's Joseph Campbell.
Well, the Terminator's so great, too, because it's a fucking robot, so you don't have to be it's a robot from the future, so you don't have to be believable. You know, it was almost like, what was that Chuck Norris movie, Silent Rage? Where that fucking, it was a horrifying movie because of the music, where that psychopath is killing everyone, and then like Chuck Norris throws him in a well at the end and kills him, and his eyes open, and it's
right.
Terrifying, but even it shouldn't have been believable because he was just a guy.
Yeah. Well, that's the great part of movies or television. You know, it's just a sheet with light on it.
Mm-hmm.
And you're sitting, and you know it's a sheet with light on it, and you get scared, or you fall in love, or you grab your honey, and you know, it's amazing the illusion the mind can accept.
I have to ask you a non-TV movie question. I was doing my Steve Guttenberg research last night, you know, reading up on you. And I read that you have a giant penis and like to show it to people. Is this true?
I'm sorry for my friend.
No, that's what I read.
That's a fair question. Jesus Christ, I didn't read that.
I read
fair
that.
Question.
Fair question, right? I mean, I read it on the internet.
If you're 58 years old and you haven't settled down yet, you have a big one.
That's true.
You have a big one.
I mean, it's just...
I got married at 19. I had no choice.
Well, I got to tell you. What can I tell you? I want to think of something really clever to say.
Just tell me. I just want to know about
you
it.
You know, I've been... The Gutenberg men
mm-hmm.
are brave men.
Mm-hmm.
We come from the sea. And in the sea, it's an atmosphere of rigor, of gusto.
Right.
So I would say that you would have to ask, but I would say that the Gutenberg men have always been happy with their lot.
Are you talking about, you come from the sea. Have you ever wrecked a sea with your giant D?
Well, what can I say?
How about this? This is an easy one. What is the best audible reaction that you've gotten to it when you've presented?
I'm engaged to be married.
Well,
before you were single. But you want to know something? Doesn't matter.
Well,
it doesn't matter if it was in the Stone Age.
Right.
If I said something now and Emily hears it.
Right.
You know.
Emily, turn off the radio. It's really not interesting.
No apple pie tonight.
Right.
I mean, it's just the way it is. So, no. Never. I don't even remember.
You don't remember.
I don't even remember any other women.
Right.
I don't remember. I just don't remember.
But they were probably very satisfied.
I don't remember.
Okay.
I don't even remember anybody else other than Emily.
That's incredible. You read that he was packing? Good for you.
I did read that.
And we talked recently about this, too. There's certain actors you hear that about or people, and you literally just think of it now every time you see them.
It's a cool club.
Willem Dafoe, James Woods. I never heard that about you, but now I'm cool even...
When
even
see each other, it's like, hey.
A more reinvigorated Steve Guttenberg fan.
You know who apparently had a real big one was... he just died.
Jim Norton.
I didn't read about Jim Norton. He just died. Landau.
Martin Landau. Oh, Martin, I never heard that.
Apparently, he had a good 12 inches.
Good for him.
Did he really?
And then he was dating young women, like, late good in life. Him. Yeah.
Well, you know, Milton Berle. And Forrest Tucker. You know Forrest Tucker, right?
No.
Forrest Tucker was on F Troop. He was the tall guy.
Okay.
You know, he was the big guy. So he was a big movie star.
Yeah.
So they actually were known for these big schlongs, and they were going to have a contest.
Uh-huh.
So Forrest Tucker pulled his out, and, you know, it was just humongous. It was at the Friars Club.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, then, and Milton was sitting there. Milton's, you know, a Jewish comic, and Forrest is a big, you know, sturdy Scottish guy. And Milton pulled his out, and the story goes, Milton pulled out only enough to win.
I heard that story, and I heard that Jackie Gleason said that to him. That's the way it was. Gleason said, Milton, just take out enough to win. That was what I heard, but that's...
And that's the story.
That's amazing.
But again, that's what I heard.
So without giving any specifics, because I'm glad that you're in a happy relationship
girth.
Now.
I'll tell you right
is
now.
Is it the girth?
It's the girth.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, you're a thick-handed man.
It's the girth, which is the whole
you're
thing.
You're a girthy-handed man.
Yeah, that's the part. Wow. Hey. Whoa.
Is it true they were going to call the movie Three Men and a Big Penis?
Sort of true.
Maybe that would have been the sequel.
Sort of true. But they, you know, they were thinking, how do we get this out there?
Right.
Does Hollywood know who's in that club?
Like, yeah, they know.
Everybody knows.
Everybody
knows.
How you doing? Hey, how are you? I'm great.
Yeah.
Me too. Yeah. Oh, good to see you.
We know how you're doing.
We know how you're doing. Yeah. You're doing pretty good.
That's why Steve got a parking spot right in front of the mansion after that first bus ride.
Right.
This isn't
a bus guy.
You don't have to take the bus.
Let him sit in the park.
And ironically, ironically, it says you turned down the lead in Big.
That one I don't remember, but I did turn down. The only one I could really remember is The Secretary with Maggie Gyllenhaal.
Where she was a submissive, is that the one?
Yes.
And the great James Spader.
Yes.
It. And I was offered that movie. I read it and I went, well, I don't get it. The spanking and all that. Smart, right? Real smart. So that was my big miss.
Well, gone on to like people love that movie.
Great movie.
Yeah.
It was well directed and well acted.
So you don't like the whole spanking BDSM thing is not your
I love it now. I mean,
back then you were like, I don't quite get it. Yeah, no, I
didn't.